certainly as we moved through and became more industrialized and now more digitized, our appetite and consumption of electricity has just gone through the roof, right? And that's not just in this country, it's everywhere as we become, you know, more and more dependent on a digital society. You know, type it in a Google search, you know, just generates emissions, right? Just because we're so dependent on devices and information, that's having a real impact on the environment and CO2 emissions.
Yeah, I think the still growing standard of living, even in industrialized countries, but mainly in the developing countries, and more people are coming in this standard of wealth, and the population is still growing. Yeah.
How are we going to sustain all these more people who want air conditioning and want fuel in their cars and the convenience of all that?
But we have more than one car, we have more than one TV, we have larger refrigerators. So these are the main drivers, I guess. Even though we have more efficient machines, cars, refrigerators, whatever, it's just the standard of living is still increasing.
And that means that we've got to get smarter about our energy production and consumption.
That's why we need to move to cleaner sources.
This is becoming a really hot topic, right? To use hydrogen in electricity generation.
So hydrogen is a gas you can burn. So it's an energy carrier. And you can create energy by burning hydrogen. And the reaction is burning with oxygen. So the product of this combustion process is water in form of steam, H2O. And the traditional energy carriers are all carbon-based. So if you burn them with oxygen, it's CO2, which we would like to avoid. So we can use it to replace traditional fuels in power plants. Instead of burning natural gas, we can burn hydrogen or a mixture of both to improve it.
There's a number of electric power companies that have what they call combined cycle power generation, which means that they're taking natural gas in, they're running it through a combustion system, a turbine, to spin a generator to make electric energy. And then they take the heat off of that and they put it into a boiler and they make steam, and then they again make some additional electric energy. So it's called a combined cycle. There are many electric power organizations that are now looking at putting hydrogen into the pipeline, so mixing it with natural gas, okay, especially decarbonized hydrogen, so that the end product going into the turbine now has a lower carbon content, okay? That is one way of helping to reduce carbon emissions and generate electric power through combustion, okay? And a combined cycle is particularly good because it really extracts every ounce of energy that can be made, that can be used to make electric power. And so it's very efficient.
15 years ago, the big turbine producers, manufacturers really started looking at how do we run a gas turbine 100% on hydrogen. And there was a lot of advances then, and so we can incorporate those into, you know, existing power generation plants, make some modifications and be able to use hydrogen. Now, the tricky thing is that if you're using gray hydrogen, that means it was probably produced from natural gas. So it doesn't really make sense to take that natural gas, convert it to hydrogen, and then displace natural gas and power generation. So it's important that hydrogen, if you do that, to really make an impact on the carbon footprint, it needs to be blue or green. Nobody really wants to see, you know, everybody's backyard with a wind turbine in it. But legitimately, to produce the amount of energy that we need by wind and solar, that's what it will look like.
Certainly the more renewables we have, they can play off of one another. What do I mean? Well, we can use solar power to generate hydrogen through an electrolyzer, right? It's not either or, it's both. And solar works very well during the day. It doesn't work that well at night. So when the sun sets or the wind stops blowing, we can store hydrogen, where you can't do that very easily with other forms of electricity, right? The sun is gonna set, the wind is gonna stop blowing, but we can store hydrogen in a cavern and bring it out of the ground, if you will, and continue to supply a pipeline, as a small example. So I think they all work together.
the most important thing about hydrogen, in my opinion, is how it can be used to store energy. The fact that you can take renewable energy, store it in some form, whether it's gas or liquid, and then one, use it when you want to use it, but two, use it where you want to use it, because now you can take this energy and you can distribute it to wherever you need it, and then utilize it. I think that's the most important thing about hydrogen, the fact that you can take renewable power and move it where you want it to when you want to use it and make it practical.
The beauty of hydrogen is we can store hydrogen and turn it on when we need it. So we have underground hydrogen caverns that can be developed, and they can store billions of cubic feet of hydrogen and make it available when it's needed at a source. Transmit it through a pipeline, take it to the end application, and if that's through a fuel cell in order to generate electricity, that can be the answer. If it's into a fill station or a pump, you know, obviously we can move it to where we need it when we need it. When you have plentiful water and you have hydropower, use it, right? When you have wind blowing, you know, certainly capture that. Hydrogen, I think, can be used in a variety of different geographies. I think it's part of the answer, not the complete answer.
You know, it's not necessarily hydrogen as a source of power. It's hydrogen as having the ability to store power for some period of time that makes it most usable and most interesting in helping us decarbonize the planet. So none of this is going to happen overnight, right? We have to do this in a gradual process, and it all starts somewhere. And so you need companies that are willing to step out, right, and try new technology. You need governments willing to step in.
I think what's possible, and this would be the finish line, is that you truly have a carbon-free world where you're generating electricity through renewable sources. Your fueling systems are powered from sources that do not have hydrocarbon or CO2 emissions. I think that is possible. I think it'll take a long time to get there. I think the best way to get people on the same page is to be reasonable around the expectations, not to go and generally be so unrealistic that we threaten entire industries, which then would drive defensive behaviors. But we say together, if we want to get to this finish line, what is a roadmap to get there? And I think society is generally aligning around this. And I think bringing all industries along as you do it is the best way to get there.